So those of you who heard Dr. Ken's talk last week, and I hope you did, because it was fiery. I mean, he was literally on fire. You'll remember that a key part of his message was about clarity and positive thinking. So basically what he was saying is when doing treatment, when we're asking the universe for what you want, you need to be clear and you need to be positive. So I'm going to expand a little bit on this idea of positive thinking in my talk this week, but I can't do it like Dr. Ken. First of all, because I'm sitting down, and it's kind of hard to get all worked up when you're sitting down. And also, I just don't have the experience. But I can do it, I can do the talk like I can. So, but before we leave Dr. Ken in the dust here, I do want to acknowledge that my talk title is something I've heard him say, and I've heard it around the teaching many times, and that is this: every thought is a prayer. So last Sunday after the service, we were sitting around talking, and knowing that this was going to be my topic, I asked Dr. Ken about the phrase. So he told me a story of being raised in the United Church and hearing a sermon. And in the sermon, the minister quoted the Apostle Paul, and the quote was this: pray without ceasing. Pray without ceasing. So Ken said this struck him as being, well, like a pretty boring thing to do, just sit around praying all the time. So I had this vision of a young Dr. Ken on a hot Okanagan Sunday, and he's just itching to go out fishing, and the minister's telling him to pray without ceasing. Like, he's like, no, I'm just not going to do that. But Ken, he grew to understand the real meaning of that statement, which I'll get to in a minute. But first, I want to take a look back at the Apostle Paul's full quote, what he actually said. And this is from the Bible. It's in 1 Thessalonians. And what he said was, rejoice always, pray without ceasing, and give thanks in all circumstances. So if we break that down, rejoice always, I think, is the biblical equivalent of don't worry, be happy. I could see the apostles going, ooh, 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 ooh. And Jesus goes in, don't worry, be happy. So that's probably where he got that part from. Give thanks in all circumstances is just simply another way of practicing the attitude of gratitude. I mean, it's right there. Give thanks in all circumstances. And pray without ceasing, as Ken came to understand it, and as he explained it to me, doesn't mean sitting on your knees all day with your hands clasped. It means that you are always praying. With every thought, in every minute of every day, you are praying. So Neil Donald Walsh said something like this. He said, everything we think is a prayer. Everything we say is a prayer. Everything we do is a prayer. The problem is, we just don't know it. So before we go any further, I guess I have to define what we mean by a thought and a prayer. So, of course, I go to Wikipedia, and I get the definition of thought, which says this, and I'm going to read it. Thought can be identified as an aim-oriented flow of ideas and associations that can lead to a reality-oriented conclusion. So I'm going to say that again. Thought is an aim-oriented flow of ideas and associations that can lead to a reality-oriented conclusion. Now, I didn't make this up. This actually comes straight from Wikipedia. So this definition will work for our purposes, But when I was looking up what a thought was, I was surprised to find out that scientists don't really know what a thought is. Like, they don't actually know how it works in the brain. So philosophers have also tried to define what a thought is. And one said, and you'll know this quote, I think, therefore I am. There's something interesting in both those quotes, the scientific and the philosophical, is that they both have two parts, the thought and the outcome. The flow of ideas leading to a reality-based outcome. And I think, therefore I am. Do you see the two parts? There's this and that. Thought is not just the cause, it's the cause and effect. That's both the scientific and one philosophical definition. So now let's take a look at the word prayer. In this context, the word prayer does not describe, you know, the traditional on your knees, hands together, now I lay me down to sleep. That is one way of praying, but it's not the only way. As the Apostle Paul said, we pray ceasingly. And as Neal Donald Walsh said, we just don't know it. Sometimes after a tragedy, you'll hear on the news, you'll hear people say we send our thoughts and prayers. Thoughts and prayers, as if they're two separate things. In Ernest Holmes' philosophy, thoughts are prayers. There's no difference. See, we're the sole creators of our own lives through our prayers. One thing I get to do as a songwriter is I get to quote myself, which is kind of cheesy, but I once wrote a song called So Close, So Far, and talking about creating, being the sole creators of our lives through our prayers, this song included the lines, we write the pages and we choose the stages to dance on. As we pray, we write the stories of our lives. We make the choices through what we ask for in our prayers. But here's the key point from Ken's talk last week and my talk this week. The universe does not pick sides. It can only say yes. The universe doesn't pick favorites. It can only manifest that which our minds create. And it's not on my side, and it's not on your side, and it's not on Ken's side. It only is, and it can only do one thing, create what we manifest. And that's why clarity is so important, because it's very easy to let negative thinking take over. Boy, tell me about it. It's easy to think about what you don't want rather than what you do want. And most of all, it's really easy to get trapped into a loop of negative thinking. At least I know that I can. I'm not talking about anybody else. But here's what I mean about a loop of negative thinking. In a way, our minds are like radio stations, and we all have this radio station. It's our very own radio station with our very own DJ in our mind. But these radio stations, they don't like playing new music all the time. They like the golden oldies, playing the same classics over and over again. So over time, we develop our favorites, our own personal top 40. Like, now I'm sure some of you will know some of these ones, like, why did I say that? Or why did I do that? Or why do I suck? Or why does nobody love me? And then there's the number one all-time classic, Counting Them Down, Casey Kasem, number one hit, What Am I Going to Do With My Life? So these radio stations are just playing these songs over and over, and we're memorizing them. Now, maybe your internal radio station has a few thoughts stuck on repeat, just like mine do. I don't know. But it's hard to get those old ones out because we know them and we're familiar with them. But here's the thing. Our radio station minds are broadcasting these thoughts to the universe, ceasingly, as Paul said. And if that's what we send out, well, that's what comes back. See, these negative thoughts, they don't just spontaneously appear. We build them up through a lifetime of experiences. And we reinforce these negative thoughts, and they become our default position. Whenever that experience or a similar experience arises again, we just play the same song over and over and over because that's what we know. Now, here's something that took me a long, long, long time to learn. And it's something I still forget, and I have to learn it again and again and again. Just as we let these negative ideas in, we can invite them out. It's as simple as that. They come in, we bring them in, and if we bring them in, we can kick them out. And we can adopt something new. We can change the station. We can play a new song. Now, speaking of a new song, as I said earlier, I can't explain this the way Ken can. I can only explain it my way, which is through a song. So I'd like to invite Barbara back to sing a new song I've written just for this occasion, and it's called Every Thought is a Prayer. Are you ready?
I would love to sing with you. Every thought is a prayer. Every road will take you somewhere. New place, new new life, new start, working to heal my heart. All I need is a change of mind. All I want is to change my mind. Big dreams, big change, big part, working to heal my heart. All I want is that light to shine. All I need is inside my mind. Every thought is a prayer. Every road will take you somewhere. Dream that dream if you dare. Every thought is a prayer. Every thought is a prayer. Every word spoken or unheard, every thought is a prayer.
Neal Klassen.
Thank you so much. Truth be told, I wrote part of that song about 7 years ago, and I was finally inspired to finish it off for this talk. So, every thought is a prayer. Every road will take you somewhere. That road can take you forward, it can take you backwards, or it can take you in a circle. But it's going somewhere, and it's up to you to map the journey. Like I said before, we write the pages, and we choose the stages to dance on. But where do these negative thoughts come from? Now, there's a column on Castanet that I really love to read by our very own Reverend Corinne Crockett. She's got this awesome column, and I'd like to read something about negative thoughts from one of her recent columns. I think this was 2 weeks ago. And she said this, and I quote, "The tendency of the brain to overemphasize what's challenging us keeps us in a constant state of stress, and we can feel victim to life's challenges. It's called the inherent negativity bias. It's the tendency of our minds to pay more attention to danger." She wrote that research shows it takes 5 positives to offset 1 negative criticism in healthy relationships. 5 positives to offset 1 negative. That's on a good day, I bet. So, you know, if you are what you eat, then you think what you see and what you hear and what you read and what you experience. The difference is that we actually have taste buds that can tell us if the food is awful, like broccoli. But the mind doesn't really know what's awful. It just absorbs. It's just a sponge. So you need to feed your brain positive thoughts. And that's hard when the going is tough. But you need those 5 positive thoughts to expel every 1 negative thought. Now again, I might not be able to describe it with words, so I'm going to sing another song. And this is a song I wrote, and it's called Strong. And it's about keeping those negative thoughts away. When the times are tough and the sea is rough and you can't find your way to shore, when the night is long and you're all alone and it's hard to care anymore, when your hope is gone How do you know you're strong? It's easy to be, oh, so carefree, when the tide is just turning your way. Oh, when everything's fine, you just roll on down that line, and faith is just a word that you say. When nothing is wrong, how do you know you're strong? Your heart, oh, it carries the seed of power and the will to succeed. If love is what you feed it, you'll find strength there when you need it. When you're down and out and you're full of doubt, just believe you'll find the way. All this too shall pass, no pain ever lasts, when you face the world unafraid. Oh, you can get along if you believe strong. You can carry on when your fear is gone, and you just know you're strong. Thank you. So I get to quote myself again. Your heart carries the seed of the power and the will to succeed. If love is what you feed it, you'll find strength there when you need it. So where do we start? If someone out there is feeling sad, lonely because of COVID, where do we start? If someone is feeling a sense of lack or separation from the world, how do we kickstart that manifestation machine to create community and a sense of purpose? Well, we start with gratitude. It's as simple as that. That was the other part of Paul's quote, pray ceaselessly and express gratitude. I can't remember exactly what he said, in everything we do. I can always think of at least three things to be grateful for. Even in my deepest periods of self-pity, I can think of two things. Can you? One or two things right now. Can each of you think of at least three things to be grateful for? Why don't you start writing them in? Type some of them in. I'd like to see them. I'm grateful for my wife's beautiful introduction. I mean, you can't beat that. No, I'm grateful that we have a home. I'm so grateful for so many things. And I can get sad and I can get depressed. But it is easy to find things to be grateful for. So we start with that. Is it possible to completely eliminate all negative thoughts? I don't know. I've never been able to do it. If, like Reverend Corrine wrote, we have a negativity bias, then we always have to stand on guard for those times when the negative thoughts creep in. Remember, and in closing, I'd like to say, every thought is a prayer. Every road will take you somewhere. So dream that dream if you dare, because every thought is a prayer. Thank you.
I love you. Yay.